Hey everyone, hope everybody has been well. Time for an update. They haven't posted a video in a few days, so I figured I'd go ahead and post one. I now have 3,500 miles on this car. That's a 2023 Tesla Model X Plaid that I traded in my 2021 Model S, refreshed Model S for. And you know, I got some interesting comments on the last video. Very controversial, but my comment about this thing basically being a minivan. So my wife and I both came up to that conclusion independently. You know, I was thinking the same thing. She actually said the same thing. And I'll tell you, there's a really good reason why I call it a minivan. I have SUVs. I currently have a GLE 580, a 2023 GLE 580. I've had, I think four Escalades, two Denalis, couple Suburbans. I've been in smaller SUVs, but you know, the minivan segment, there's a defining characteristic to me, and that is when you sit down, do you see hood or do you not see hood? Because most minivans have a very tiny hood. That's just how they're designed. The engine sits back, transmission sits back. It's either transaxle or all-wheel drive, whatever. But they've always been designed so the front end is a little bit short. And this car is no different. This is a little bit shorter than a Model S. The nose dives down quite a bit. And the defining characteristic for me is when you sit inside the passenger or the driver's seat front, if you look out over the hood, do you see hood? Do you not see hood? This car, you see absolutely zero hood. I'm 6 feet tall, so I'm not short. I'm not, you know, 7 feet like some people, but when I sit in my seat, I see zero hood. All I see is the base of the windshield and ground, road. If I lean all the way forward, so my head is directly above the steering wheel, my head touching the sun visor, I still don't see hood. All I see is road and the base of the windshield. To me, that's a defining characteristic, short nose minivan. And I mean, you could call this an SUV, but really what's the difference? An SUV to me has a substantial rear trunk area. Basically like a pickup with a shell, only it's designed to have to be a passenger compartment with a storage area. To me, I mean, and minivans can be like that too, but minivans are like a rectangular box. This happens to be a slope down back end. So that's just me, you know, don't take offense. It's just my opinion. I know someone was like, oh, you said minivan twice. I can't watch your review anymore. It just disgusts me. Okay, well, if it's a personal affront to you and your manhood is really bothered by the fact that your car is called a minivan, I don't know what to tell you, man. You know, I don't feel bad for you. I feel bad for you. I don't know what to say. It's just my opinion. Okay, there's nothing wrong with this car. Someone said it sounds like somebody who couldn't be any more miserable with their car. And to me, that's not the case. I absolutely love this car. If you were to ask me, would I buy this car again? I'd say, yeah. But is it my first choice? Absolutely not. I got this car strictly for tax reasons. I had the Model S. I loved it. That car is perfect. If I were to get another one, I would have gotten another Model S. But it doesn't qualify for a Schedule 179 business deduction because it's not over 6,000 pounds gross vehicle weight. My accountant said I had to have a deduction, and I went and got this. And that's the only reason why I have this. To me, this car is very slab-sided. For the most part, I don't think it's their best design. I actually think that the Y is a pretty good looking car. It's got nice haunches on it. The fenders kind of stick out a little bit. The back end looks pretty good. It's got the little wing in the back off of the lip of the deck. I think that's a fantastic design feature. This car, I don't know if you guys know or not, the Model X was designed with a spoiler that goes up and down at speed. This spoiler used to go up and down, and they had so many problems with the motors on the spoiler that they decided to put it in a fixed up position. So this is an afterthought. I don't know if you guys know that or not, but this wing is an afterthought. They were too cheap to deal with the motor or improve the motor or figure out what was wrong with it and improve it. So instead they put it up. So if you look at it, it's a combination wing, whatever, that's supposed to dip into this area and tuck in and be flat. The Model Y, you can get a nice little carbon fiber spoiler that runs along the back like the Model X or Model S Plaid and the Model 3 Performance. And I think that's a sharp look. I love that look, having that tiny little carbon fiber detail. This car, I'm not digging the wing. I just don't, you can't put it down either. It's an afterthought. Outside of that, the car is super slab-sided. The thing I loved most about the Model S is that it has the fat fenders, especially the refreshed S. From any angle, you look at it from the back, the car sits super low. I mean, you can't have a car any lower than a Model S when it's sitting in its regular position, even in medium height. You drop it down to low highway ride height, that thing is just gorgeous. The stance on that thing, the wheels are tucked in, everything looks beautiful. But the biggest thing for me are the big fat haunches, like the big, like, you know, like if you had a bulldog with his legs ready to pounce sitting on the ground. And the front, I mean, look at the front. Look at the way the wheels are tucked in so far. This car, the stance is just miserable on this thing. And I'm not gonna put wheel spacers on because I don't think it's safe. These wheels are torqued to 130 foot-pounds. And usually when you do spacers, you get aftermarket studs that are on the spacers, and the spacers themselves go on the factory studs. And you torque that down to 130 foot-pounds. But I don't think you can torque any factory stud, or I'm sorry, any aftermarket stud that comes on a spacer to 130 foot-pounds. Most of those wheels are torqued to, I think about 85, 88, 90 foot-pounds at most vehicles. This car is 130 foot-pounds. Ford F-150 is 150 foot-pounds. The Mustang GT uses Ford F-150 hubs, 150 foot-pounds on a Ford Mustang GT. So trying to put spacers on this car and torquing him down to 130, not a great idea. I don't think the aftermarket studs can handle it unless you put in like ARP studs or something. That can be done. You can put ARP studs in, that would work. But also the converse of that, torquing your wheels to 88 foot-pounds to accommodate your spacers is also not safe, because this car with the 22 inch wheels is designed to have 130 foot-pounds of torque, lug nut torque. So I won't put spacers on. I hate the stance. The wheels are tucked in way too far. I mean, look at that. It's like it's almost sitting in 2 inches from the edge of the wheel. The Model S does not do that. It's flat. The wheels are tucked in. The Model S, the front fenders stick out because it has massive tires in the front. The rear fenders stick out because it has massive tires in the rear. Like the 305 21s, I think, on the Model S, or 295 21s. These are 285 22s. So I have 3,500 miles on this car. My tires, I think, are... Let's see, where are my wear bars? I'd say about half. They're about half toast, which is about right. These tires, are Continental Contact 6s, have a tread wear rating of about 250, which is pretty bad. I think Michelin Pilot Sports are 280 or 300, so they last a little bit longer. This car has the negative camber built in, non-adjustable camber arms. So these tires are supposed to last approximately 6,000 miles at most, and that's about par for the course. So I have removed the fixed camber arms, and I had intuitive adjustable camber arms installed. I'm running zero camber right now per the instructions on the intuitive parts. It came with instructions. So I'm running zero camber. I've noticed the tire wear has slowed down a bit, and I'm pretty happy with that. I think after this, I'm going to switch to Michelin Pilot Sport All Season, which have a tread wear rating of 500. Those should last significantly longer. That was one of the issues that I had with my Model S. The Model S tires would last me roughly 8,000 miles, and they're $1,100 a set for the rears. And that car also had fixed camber arms that had negative camber, which was even worse when the car was in low mode on the highway above 70 or 75 miles an hour. It was unfixable. So I switched that car to intuitive camber arms too. So that being said, the car is outside of the camber issues, the looks. If I were to choose another car, I would definitely choose a Model S. If I had a choice and it wasn't this tax issue of mine, I would have another Model S, because I don't need a Model X. It's always just me in the car. I don't need the room. I do carry a lot of things, and that's something I'm going to touch on in just a second here. This car is miserable for carrying things. In the Plaid configuration, well, let's just talk about it now. In the Plaid configuration, this car is a six-seater. So you get an option of, I believe, 7-seater, which means you get a bench in the middle. Oh, my car washing towels. Sorry about the mess, guys. It's my dog's car seat. So at first I thought this would be really comfortable and really cool, and I love these middle seats. But these seats, I don't know if you know or not, in the 6-seat configuration do not recline. The seat back does not recline independently of the seat bottom. It's a fixed position. So the seat dips in the back and gives you the impression of reclining, but really it's just the seat tilting. So the seat slides forward. It slides forward, it goes back electrically, and it tilts, but it actually tilts. The seat back does not articulate at all. So therein lies the problem. As far as hauling cargo, you can never fold these seats down. You'll never have that option. So the third row does fold down, okay? And that's the problem I'm having with this car. The Model S could swallow a tremendous amount of stuff in the trunk. I have put in 2 huge hefty tubs full of stuff, side by side, 2 large suitcases, you know, check-in suitcases, along with some bags in addition to that, and it fits no issues without even folding down the seat. When you fold down the seat, you get a lot more room. But in this car, what happens is, and this is kind of, I'm really surprised by this, okay? So this car has a very small trunk, very small compared to the Model S. You can fold the seats down, of course, and they fold down nicely. You get a nice flat thing. But what do you see there? This area right here is wide open to the entire passenger compartment. So I found that anything I put in, like the Tesla Model S is about from here to about here in trunk space. It's ridiculously huge. And this is more than half the seat folded. So without that seat folded, you get from here to here, which is just useless. So if you're using this space for actually hauling stuff, everything you put in this back area, because there's no barrier, flies forward. And the way this car is designed, I don't know why, these front seats sit kind of high. So everything that flies forward, I've had stuff like this box of coffee under here. I've got this Starbucks coffee down here. I've had things slightly smaller, shorter than that, actually slide forward and hit the back of my feet as I'm driving. I mean, it's just horrendous how this car handles cargo. So, I mean, if they had designed some kind of divider here, that would be fine. It would work perfectly. But there's no divider to be had. So I can't fold the seat down and put a big box in between the seats. There's just no way to effectively use this. So the other issue is this area right here is very, very flimsy. And there's no cargo cover. That's something I didn't realize till after I bought the car. There is absolutely no cargo cover for this car. Anything you put in here is in plain sight. So what I've done is I've stacked 15% limo tent on top of the factory tent, which takes me down to like, I think below 5%. So it's really hard to see, and even if you have your face right next to the window, which helps quite a bit. But I don't understand why there's no optional cargo cover. Like when this is in the down configuration, they could have easily put in some kind of cargo cover here on the side. The Model Y has one. The Model Y actually has a cargo cover, and I believe the Model Y will work if the seat is down, and if the seat is up, the cargo cover will work. This car, there's no option for a cargo cover. There are no aftermarket cargo covers. There's nothing. So in terms of carrying cargo in this car, it's terrible. So most of the time I have the seat up, or in some cases where I'm carrying more stuff back here, like because I travel every week, I have the seats partially folded down, like almost halfway. It's kind of crazy. I didn't expect that. This technically and functionally for me, for my needs, this car holds less cargo than my Model S. Unless I start putting stuff on the back seats. And again, that's unsecured as well. So, you know, that's the problem there. So on the pluses, and to reiterate, I love this car. I don't love its looks. I like the Model S far better. So if I'm saying that this car is ugly, it's just in relation, relative to the Model S. I love the Model S. I hate the Model X. The Model X is a great looking car all by itself. You know, it's not exactly a minivan. It just feels like a minivan when you're driving it, okay? That's my opinion. Everything else is wonderful. The car drives exceptionally well. It's so much smoother than the Model S. It is literally a magic carpet ride, and I say that over and over and over again. I tell everybody this. Nothing rides like a Model X. Well, the new Model X. I don't know what the old ones rode like. Actually, I take that back. I had a loaner once, and it drove like a truck. And I don't know if that had air suspension or steel suspension, spring suspension or what, but this car is just beautiful. I love everything about it, the way it rides. The updated headlights are wonderful, so much better than the headlights I had on my S. My S was the refreshed S, pre-redesigned headlights and taillights. So it had the old headlights. So, you know, the headlights are great. The stereo, not as good as the S. The seats from the passenger compartment, sitting in the driver's or the passenger seat, this car feels exactly like being in the S, except for the view out front. Looking out front, and I'll show you. You don't see hood. I'm above the steering wheel right now. My camera is actually at the same level as the rear view mirror. You don't see hood. You see the base of the windshield. And I'm leaned forward. I'm literally, and I'll put my hand right here. That's where my camera is right now, right here at the windshield, at the top of the windshield looking down, and you don't see hood. And that's why this car has that aura of minivan-ish feel to it. Because I had a Toyota Sienna way, way back in the day at a Chrysler Town and Country, and that's exactly what it felt like. Okay, so that's my update. I'll try to come up with some new stuff here and there. I did notice one thing. The car is very smooth. It's very quiet, much better than the S. I love it. However, there's one thing that this car does that I haven't figured out yet. It's a little bit noisy here, so I'm gonna close this up, get back in the car. So it does this auto present again, you know, it just flips open, then it fights me on the open. I don't like that. Okay. So one thing this car does is once you get in the car and you start driving, at about 30 miles an hour or so, this car develops like a turbine, almost like a fan, like a mechanical fan vibration underneath the driver's feet. And I think it's some kind of pump for the battery cooling system, because it's not related to your driving speed. And of course, we don't have an engine, so it's not related to the speed that you're driving. But all of a sudden, it kicks in at about 30, 35. I never had that in the Model S. I did feel that in the other loaners, and that's what I sensed is like wheel vibration. But it's in this car. Every time you get in, you get hit a certain speed, it kicks in, and you can feel it. It's not bad. You get used to it, and you kind of ignore it, but it's something that you do sense. And again, here. No hood. You don't see a hood. You don't see a hood at all. And that's the problem. Outside of this, I mean, this is basically Model S. This is all Model S. I don't think it's any wider. I don't think it's any bigger. It's about Model S. Anyways, that's my update. So I'm sorry I rambled on and on and on. But I try to fit as much information as I can. I hope you guys really review what I said about the tires on this car. If you're going to get the 21-inch wheels, plan on spending a lot of money on tires. Plan on spending at least $1,000 every 6,000 to 8,000 miles on tires. You know, 1,000 to 1,100, whatever. Unless you switch to a different tire that lasts a little longer. The Continental Connie Sport 6s are rated at 250 UTGAAs, UTAAs, or whatever it is for the tire rating. The Michelin Pilot Sport All Seasons are 500, so they should last significantly longer. The 22s, the stock 20s are probably your best bet if you're really concerned about tire wear, because I think those are already, they already have a tread wear rating of 500, the tires that come on that's in that size. At least I saw at the dealership. You can get the arms from Intuitive. It's letter N, number 2, I-T-I-V-E. Fantastic quality camber arms. Having those installed, there's a number of shops. They give you a recommended shop you can go to get the arms installed. I did mine myself because I have lift in the garage, and then I went and got the alignment done. Just keep in mind that most shops that want to do this work will put the arms in, and then they'll send out to get the alignment done because most shops don't have the alignment rack. Keep that in mind. The shops that I talked to were like, maybe we can get it done in a day, but the alignment on these cars is real tricky. Sometimes it takes a day and a half. So plan on that, but it's well worth the expense. The peace of mind of knowing that your tires are wearing evenly. Once you do the arms, you get much more wear out of the tires, because if you don't do the arms, it's the inner edge that wears down to the cords and will leave you stranded. There's plenty of tire left on the outside and the middle. It's just the inner edge becomes so worn that the tire has to be replaced. With the camber arms, the tire wears evenly and it should last double, if not triple, that. Design-wise, like I said, Model X. It looks good for what it is. I'm not going to knock it. I think it's a beautiful car. It's just not that nice relative to the Model S. I like the Model S far better. So if you guys are reading into my words and thinking that I hate the Model X, I don't. I love the Model X. I like the way it looks. I don't love the way it looks. I like the way it looks. If I had a choice, I would get a Model S every single time. I would get a Model S. For tax reasons only, I got this car. And it serves the same purpose. It's not as fast. The Plaid Model X does not launch as fast as a Model S. The Model S gives you that insane 1.9 0 to 60. This car is like 3 point something, I think, or 2.9, 3.1, whatever it is. It feels like a dual motor S, you know. But once you get up to speed, a rolling start, this car has tremendous passing power, effortless all day long. So it's well worth the money to get the Plaid, especially with the price drop. So I hope you know, a tiny bit of this information helps you guys in some way or another. I'm really not trying to sway you into buying a Model X or not buying a Model X. I'm just trying to give you guys stuff that I found as a 5-time Tesla owner, of stuff that I'm still finding out about this car, even though I thought I knew everything about this car and saw reviews. This is stuff that, you know, you just notice, you know, as you own the car. So let me see how many. Oh, one more thing. One last thing. This is really important. Okay. Energy usage. I have 3,436 miles on this car. I've had it for a month. You'll see my watt hours of usage is around, it's hovering around 409 watt hours per mile. That is so much more than I ever used in my Model S. My Model S with the 21-inch wheels was at about 340 something, you know, on a bad day, like maybe 360 in a bad, you know, battery charge. So this car uses significantly more energy to do the same things as any other Tesla because it's a big girl. She's a big girl, you know? She doesn't have a fat ass, but she's a big girl. Yeah, fat ass like the Model S. So when you charge this car at the same 50 amp circuit as a Model S, a Model S charges at between 42 and 44 miles per hour. This car charges at 34 to 35 miles an hour. And it's charging at the same rate, utilizing the same energy, but because the efficiency is so much less, it's telling you what you're going to get for that level of charging. I thought there was something wrong with the car, and I actually took it in to get it looked at. And they said, nope, everything is fine. And so I looked on the Tesla website, and sure enough, it says that's what it is. So on a supercharger, on a 250-kilowatt supercharger, my Model S would charge peak when the battery was almost completely dead. I saw 1,100 miles an hour on that thing. When it was almost dead, 250 kilowatt hours, kilowatts of energy, 1,100, 1,150, I saw, I think, one time as it was charging, max charge rate. This car maxes out at about 780, 790. I've never seen it hit above 790 on a 250 kilowatt supercharger. So that's how much more inefficient this car is versus the Model S. So be prepared to be at the supercharger longer. Be prepared to have more time on the charger at home to get to a full charge. And I guess be prepared to pay more money. I mean, it's not as like gas prices, but you know, energy is energy. You still pay more. So keep that in mind. It'll take longer to charge this car. And it's accepting the same charge rate. Everything is working the same. It's just so much more inefficient that it takes that much longer to charge. And it tells you it's charging that much slower. Okay? Just keep that in mind, guys. Okay. Till the next time. Bye.